Hello there. Why does my dog have a stiff back? This video 8 is a 9 video series that discusses conditions that cause limping or a stiff back in dogs. Welcome to A Bridge Over Troubled Waters, one of Simon Garfunkel's best songs. Unfortunately, I can't play the song because that will cause a copyright infringement. So, I'll just talk about the song itself. I have no idea what inspired and led Simon and Garfunkel to record that beautiful song. But I listen to it each time I feel like I'm drowning in troubled waters. But what has a bridge over troubled waters got to do with this spondylosis deformans? A degenerative disease of dogs? The answer? Not much. But the lyrics to that song paint a very vivid picture of how spondylosis develops. Dogs too can construct bridges between vertebral bones to cross over troubled herniated discs. What is a degenerative disease? This is a disease that is triggered by natural wear and tear and that eventually renders an organ or tissue non-functional. Both canine intervertebral disc disease and spondylosis deformans are degenerative diseases. But what is spondylosis deformans? Spondylosis is a low-grade inflammatory condition. It occurs around the edges of the vertebral bones and junction with the intervertebral discs. Excuse me. Most of the literature I have reviewed describe it as non-inflammatory condition. But I beg to differ. Most of the spondylosis cases I have encountered with a single or multiple intervertebral spaces involved had some form of pain, some pain from mild to severe. This degenerative process leads to new bone growth that extends out as spurs and eventually joins together to form bridges between vertebral bones. The medical term for these bone growths is osteophytes. The pace of osteophyte formations is linked to the level of activity of the dog, where there might be a genetic component in boxers. While boxers are very prone to spondylosis, any middle-aged to old large breed dog can be affected. Spondylosis can occur between a single intervertebral space, between separate intervertebral spaces, or between a continuous band of intervertebral spaces. Spondylosis can affect the whole vertebral column. However, it is commonly found in the thorax, lumbar, and sacral regions between the 11th thoracic to 7th lumbar plus 1st coxae vertebrae. Here is an image of a dog with a normal lumbar spine and thoracic spine, right? You can see the spaces between the vertebrae all the way. They look good. They look good. There's no spondylosis. There are no osteophytes. All these are spinal nerves and arteries and veins down here, right? But in between the vertebrae, the intervertebral discs look very healthy. Very healthy, right? Very healthy, right? The blood spaces here show there's still some cartilage there. Right? There's still cartilage there, it's not worn. But that's a pretty healthy spinal cord. Okay, now compare that one with this one, right? This dog was presented me for not eating and losing weight. We did a blood panel, it came negative, you know, it was unremarkable. There was nothing else going with the liver, the kidneys, or any other organs. Then we took an x-ray of this dog, right? And this is what we found. extremely bad spondylosis. You can see starting all the way from the 7th lumbar vertebrae, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Right? That one area looks in the thoracic vertebrae look good. 11, between 11 and 12, 12 and 13. But when you start from first lumbar vertebra here, you can see the bridge here is almost complete. Right? There's only this place that is left to be covered up. You go from the second to the third, the bridge is almost complete to be opened, right? For people to cross across, right? Now from the third all the way to the seventh, there's a continuous bridge, bridging all these bones together. This is very severe spondylosis. One other thing to note, you can see there's disc herniation between each of those vertebral discs. You have disc material right there. You see there that spinal cord looks good. But once you get here, start having a gelatinous material from the nucleus pulposus prolapses into the spinal cord. This dog was in a lot of pain, just too much pain. Then you look at the facets where the bones join together, you can see there's a lot of inflammation there. There's even fusion of the bones there. There's still another bridge almost complete there, right there. Right? This dog was in such pain that eventually we are unable to control the pain from this back, and I had to advise the owners to put the dog down and alleviate any more pain and so on. Why and how do dogs develop spondylosis? The cause of spondylosis both in human beings and dogs is not well understood. But here's my theory. Our bone skeleton and its muscles accomplishes four functions. One, it gives us shape or form. Look at me. I got some shape. Right? Two arms outstretched. You got the exoskeleton making me stand up right here. Right? That's courtesy of a good vertebral column. It offers mobility, right? It allows me to dance, right? It allows me to dance. If I don't have any pain at the back, I can dance the night away, courtesy of the vertebral column. The vertebral column also offers support and general protection to the internal body organs, all right? My heart, my lungs, my stomach, they are all hung inside there, on the skeleton. The skeleton also offers specialized protection to the brain and the spinal cord, all right? To get to the cranium, to the brain, you must crack the cranium, which is extremely hard. These functions are similar for all organisms with an exoskeleton. The nervous system coordinates the functions of all the body organs and makes us function as a very one single unit. For that reason, the nervous system is heavily protected by the vertebral column, with the immune system keeping a close eye for any breaches of that protective system. The intervertebral discs are shock absorbers. The vertebral bones are also offering flexibility, mobility, and stability of the skeletal system. The intervertebral discs are the weakest link in the protection of the nervous system. They bear the brunt of all compressive and other impact forces passing through the vertebral column. These forces are linked to disc collapse and herniations. Like Simon Garfunkel's bridge over troubled waters, intervertebral discs and the troubled waters and osteophytes the developing bridges. If the immune system notices any deficiencies in the stability of the vertebral column that could affect the function of the spinal cord, it takes action immediately. These actions could include synthesis of new bone or cartilage to stabilize the vertebral column. That's how osteophytes form as reinforcements of an unstable vertebral column. Degeneration is a slow and insidious process. It erodes the stability of the vertebral column and forces the immune system to continuously stimulate osteophyte formation and development of patches when two osteophytes coalesce. While bridges you stabilize and protect the spinal cord, the rigidity of the vertebral column will reduce its flexibility and mobility. But that is the nature of life. You must lose something to gain something else at all times. You must lose something to gain something else. If you don't lose anything, you don't gain anything. What are the clinical signs of spondylosis? You have a stiff and arched back as the characteristic sign. Very stiff arched back. Stiff or coach's gait. Chronic and debilitating pain. Depression, loss of appetite, and loss of weight. How do you diagnose spondylosis? Radiographs will confirm diagnosis of spondylosis. How do you treat spondylosis? Weight, physical activity, and pain management are the cornerstones of dealing with spondylosis. Your veterinarian will determine the right treatment for your dog. And that's the end of the video. Now you know how dogs develop bridges between troubled herniated discs. If this video was helpful, subscribe, share it, comment, or ask a question below. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video.